Welcome back. This week we are continuing on our IVF journey and talking about the egg retrieval process.
Yeah, we're going to be going into what is egg retrieval, how does it happen, and what can you do to prepare.
In case this is your first time meeting us, I'm Sarah. I am a board certified OBGYN and IVF doc, now doing IVF myself.
Yep, I'm Kurt. I'm a board certified pediatrician. I'm a first time dad and the cheerleader for going through all of this process.
Yes. And we are
the Doctors Bjorkman.
You may have met us 2 years ago when we were trying to get knocked up with our first kiddo.
Yeah, and during that process, we detailed everything about getting pregnant, evidence-based trip through pregnancy and parenting tips, and now find ourselves trying for baby number two.
Yeah, so this journey has certainly been different as we found ourselves faced with some male factor infertility and now are doing IVF.
Yeah, so we've already done some videos you may have seen about IVF basics, some of the medication videos, administering those, and what to expect with IVF videos.
Right. So this week is all about the egg retrieval. You have done those 8 to 12 days of injectable medications, and now your team says those follicles are ready to go. You took your trigger shot, and you are wondering, what is next?
So maybe you can start by saying, what is an egg retrieval?
So an egg retrieval is a minor surgical procedure where your doctor goes and drains all of those follicles that you have been growing using a very specialized kind of vacuum suction.
Gotcha. Okay. And is there anything special that you need to do to prepare for that?
So first and foremost, the most important thing is to make sure that you take your trigger shot correctly and at the exact time your clinic tells you to.
Yeah, the role of this trigger shot is it causes those follicles to go through their final maturation process and helps the eggs kind of be released from the wall of that follicle so then they're ready to be retrieved on retrieval day. You then know that ovulation is going to happen about 36 hours after that, and that retrieval time is planned for just before ovulation.
Exactly. So the thing about this medical procedure and egg retrieval that is a little different than any other medical procedure you may have is that there isn't a set date and time that it's going to happen. Your retrieval happens once those eggs are ready, and that can vary by a few days. So usually patients are triggered around day 10, and then your retrieval is always 2 days after that trigger, but that trigger shot can vary by a couple days either way.
Yeah, and as you can imagine, this can be pretty frustrating and honestly just challenging for you as a patient, just because you're trying to coordinate with your work schedule, childcare, if you have other kids already, or even just like life events and having to kind of last minute say like, oh, the procedure's going to be today or it's going to be tomorrow can be tricky.
Yeah. So something I always try to encourage patients is to kind of keep a flexible mindset as you are going through all of this.
So, you take the trigger shot. Right. What's next?
Well, as we said, 36 hours later, it is going to be retrieval time. Because this is a minor surgical procedure where you will be getting anesthesia, your team will instruct you not to eat or drink after midnight the night before your procedure.
Yeah, so if you walk in and the anesthesiologist asks you how your breakfast was, this is definitely a trick question, as the answer should be like, oh, I haven't had any breakfast.
Right.
Thanks for asking.
So again, the morning of the retrieval, you are gonna need a ride. You'll need someone to bring you because you need a ride home after getting anesthesia.
Yeah, and if you have a male partner who's participating in the IVF process, just as a heads up and a reminder, he's gonna be expected to give a fresh sperm sample, which is gonna be used for insemination that day often, and this generally happens that same day. Generally, also, it's recommended for 2 to 7 days of abstinence prior to giving that semen sample. So keep that in mind to have your partner be prepared for that as you're going through the stimulation process.
On that day of, I always tell patients that I recommend you come in comfy clothes and your favorite or lucky socks. As you get there, you will change into a hospital gown, but often you can keep your socks on if you want. Of course, after the procedure, sometimes you're a little sore or sleepy, and so it's nice to have comfy clothes that are just easy to change into on your way home.
So next we're going to talk about what to expect on the actual day of your retrieval. Yeah. On that day, your team is probably going to ask you to arrive about 45 minutes before your actual retrieval time. Yeah. This is so that they've got time to get an updated weight, vitals, they're going to place an IV that they're going to use for medications and the anesthesia, yeah, and have you do other things like changing into a hospital gown, putting on a hairnet, hair cover, and then also you're gonna meet the anesthesiology team and the physician team and do other things like reviewing consent forms, verifying your name, date of birth, and other things pre-procedure like that.
Correct. So as the doc, I always see if you have any questions, as well as review that last ultrasound you had so that we can discuss how many eggs we're expecting to get. We know that not every follicle has an egg in it and not all eggs are mature, but we hope to find mature eggs in follicles that were greater than 14 millimeters on your last scan. It gives us a pretty good estimate of how many eggs to expect. I also have a motto though, no follicle left behind. So we drain all of the follicles, even the small ones, and then let the embryologist look through that fluid for the eggs. Often the smaller ones are immature, but we still try, but we do need nice mature eggs for insemination.
So we are just getting ready for my retrieval. My IV is in and I've got my little hairnet for the party hat. So talk to our nurses, talk to anesthesia, talk to the docs, and we're ready to rock. So we'll know how many eggs soon.
Then it's time to head back to the procedure room.
Yes.
So usually at that time, they'll have you empty your bladder and walk back to that procedure room on your own.
Mm-hmm.
The anesthesiology team, once you get back there, is going to hook you up to their monitor so they can follow your vitals throughout the procedure. And then they're able to give you the medications that put you off to sleep and make it so you don't remember anything from the procedure. And you really just wake up feeling like you had a great nap. One thing that's important for you to know is that you almost never have to put in a breathing tube for this, and so you're breathing on your own during the procedure.
Yes. So once you're nice and sleepy, we then place the speculum in the vagina and clean the vagina out really well with saline. We know that betadine and other soaps can be harmful to the eggs, so we just use a lot of normal saline. A sterile cover then gets placed on that transvaginal ultrasound probe, and a long needle is attached. For the beginning, that needle just rests in the needle guide above the ultrasound.
Yeah. And then this is when the doctor and physician team uses that probe placed mm-hmm. in the vagina and using that transvaginal ultrasound to identify each ovary, mm-hmm. check and make sure the lining of the uterus looks good, yeah, and then beginning the procedure.
So to do the procedure, a really long needle, as we said, is attached to that transvaginal ultrasound, and then the needle is carefully advanced through the back of the vaginal wall into the ovary. Once the needle's in a follicle, we step on a pedal that activates a suction that drains all of the fluid out of the follicle, and we kind of watch it collapse. That fluid is then handed off to our embryology lab, and they look for eggs.
Yeah, and these eggs are microscopic, so the embryology lab has specialized microscopes mm-hmm. to look through the fluid to find those eggs. And then they're actually usually able to give a running tally to the physician team about how many eggs they're actually finding in the fluid that's collected.
Yes. So after every follicle is drained on one side, we then take the needle out, flush that needle, and move to the other ovary. After the procedure is complete, we just need to look and check for bleeding. So we put that speculum back in, look at those two puncture sites at the back of the vagina. Again, there's only two puncture sites because you use one to go into the ovary on the left side and one to go into the ovary on the right side. And we just want to make sure those are hemostatic. If needed, every once in a while, we have to hold pressure for a couple minutes to get that bleeding to stop. And rarely, we have to put a little stitch in the back of the vagina.
Yeah. Overall, this procedure is pretty quick. It only
yeah.
takes about 15 minutes.
Yep.
You're then wheeled back to recovery room, and then it takes you about another 10 minutes or so to wake up from anesthesia sedation.
Yeah.
When you wake up, you feel like you've had a nice nap, and Sarah herself felt like she had the greatest nap of all time that morning.
So before you go home, we want to make sure that you can eat and drink a little something, that you're not nauseous. We want to make sure you can get up and walk around and pee.
Yeah. And then while you're in the recovery room, mm-hmm. Hopefully the team is going to be able to come and give you the good news with the final egg count of what they were able to collect with their procedure.
So from the moment you arrive at the clinic in the morning till the time you are ready to go home after the procedure is usually around 2 hours. So I briefly want to mention the complications or possible risks of an egg retrieval. So again, an egg retrieval is a minor surgical procedure, and all procedures have some risks. So egg retrievals are done using transvaginal ultrasound, which is really cool because this is an ultrasound guided procedure. And so we always have our eyes on your pelvis and what is happening with that needle. But the thing that your doc is going to counsel you about are the risk of bleeding, infection, damage to surrounding structures. There are a lot of important things around your ovaries, your bowel, your blood vessels, your bladder. We're really careful not to poke anything that we aren't supposed to. And sometimes we will not retrieve an ovary or leave some follicles behind if we can't safely access them.
All right, so it is the afternoon after my egg retrieval. I've kind of just been napping all afternoon. I felt great right when I woke up for my egg retrieval. The nurses had given me these little heat packs and I felt like a million bucks. I thought I could run out of there afterwards. And then sort of as the day has gone on, I'm feeling less awesome. Just kind of like symptoms of kind of free fluid here in my abdomen, which is normal after a retrieval to have fluid in your abdomen. Belly's kind of bloated. Feel a little kind of pain just all through my belly and up here through my shoulder, kind of referred pain again because of that fluid in the abdomen. Definitely feel like somebody kicked me in the ovaries, but overall feeling pretty good. Got some Tylenol number 3 if I need it. Already had an ice cream cone, and so now just excited to get things going.
Then, what should you do kind of the day of your procedure and the day after that? The most important thing that you should be doing is rest and recover. Again, you had a minor surgical procedure. You were under anesthesia. Don't be making any important decisions that day. Right. Don't be driving after the anesthesia. Go home, put your feet up, and relax.
Yes. Patients are often a little crampy and uncomfortable after their procedure, and so things we usually recommend for pain are Tylenol. Often your clinic may prescribe something a little stronger if you need it, like Tylenol with codeine, heat pack, ice pack, whatever feels comfortable or makes you feel better are things that you can also do to help with some of that crampy pain after your retrieval.
After your procedure, a lot of the cool and fun stuff is actually happening in the lab. Over the next 5 to 7 days, the embryologists are usually able to keep you updated about how many eggs were mature, mm-hmm. how many of those eggs fertilized normally, and then how that embryo development is going after that.
Yeah. If you are planning a fresh embryo transfer, you do need to start progesterone on that night of your egg retrieval. And if you are planning a frozen embryo transfer, then you will have your retrieval and you will then kind of wait a couple weeks and make a plan with your clinic of when you will be doing your frozen embryo transfer, which is what our next video is going to be all about: the embryo transfer, how to prepare, what to expect. And we will cover that all next week.
Bye, guys.
So one of our embryologists just texted me that the eggs are going to be inseminated with sperm, and they're doing that using what we call standard insemination. The sperm looked good enough that we could just put the sperm in a dish with the eggs and let them do their thing. And so that is great news. A lot of clinics do a lot of ICSI, and depending on...
And ICSI is just where you're directly
injecting a sperm into each egg.
Okay. Whereas the lab here thought the eggs and the sperm looked good enough that they could just kind of...
The sperm was good enough that we could just do standard insem, which is... there are pluses and minuses to each, which your clinic will talk to you about. It was just fun to get the report from the text from our embryologists who are now taking care of our little
embryos that are
and sperm that are hopefully gonna fertilize become embryos normally, yeah, and turn into embryos. So tomorrow morning we'll get a fertilization report to know how many fertilized normally, and then kind of continue that journey over 5 or 6 days to become blastocysts, mm-hmm, that can be frozen or transferred or biopsied and things like that. So good news.
We're doctors.
But not your doctors.
Anything we've said in this video is for education or entertainment purposes only.
It is not medical advice.
Any specific medical questions you have should be directed to your provider.